All right. Just want to remind you of a couple of things as we get going here this morning. As you can see, this will be our first communion in the tent, so we're gonna move along towards that this morning. A couple of announcements. First of all, if you are interested in finding out more about this church, tomorrow night doing a our 101 class, our membership class here. And so some of you have already signed up for that. We're ready to go. We'll meet at 6:30. The youth, actually Ruth provides dinner for the youth group. If you have not yet signed up for the 101 class and you still want to come, please let me know today so I can tell Ruth we're going to have a few more for dinner. And that would be great. So thanks for doing that. Also, and then there's a men's retreat coming up at the end of the month. Bert Lazowski is still taking signups and money for that. So men, if you want to go to that retreat, that's March 27th through 29th. And then finally, we have a Project Touch table every week in the back there. And so the move, you know, some things might get forgotten. I think there's plenty of clothes for Project Touch, so they're still looking for food and things like that. See Pat Toby or Rick Toby. They can tell you items that are needed at Project Touch, all right? Okay. I see him walking around, and he hates to have things pointed out, but Kevin Grube has done more to get this move happening in this church than anyone. Michelle has been great as well, but Kevin has just put in so many extra hours. So as he appears right now, let's give Kevin a hand. It was a monumental job. We had the final walkthrough at the old property this past Monday. We passed with flying colors. Gary Dixon also did an awful lot of work over there for us at literally no cost at all. And so the building looked great. In fact, it almost looked like, hey, let's move in here. But man, you know, this is even better. So everything was great. We passed. We'll be getting a deposit back from that building. So that is really great. And so we want to thank Kevin for all of that. Now, because it's Kevin, I also want you to note that for your notes today, you either need to write upside down or turn this thing around, all right? So whatever you prefer to do is fine. If you like writing upside down, that might be if you can read upside down, I suppose you should be able to write upside down. That's what happens when you do a move almost single-handedly, and then the pastor doesn't send you the notes until like the day before, even though he's had them prepared for months. So anyway, just wanted to let you know about that. How are you today? Everybody, yeah, we have birds in here too. This is a night. It's also an aviary. Just warning, you might want to wear a hat inside the tent. You know, you never know. Never know. One of the most humiliating experiences I ever had as a kid when I was in junior high. This is a terrible thing to happen to a junior high kid, especially in front of the school bully. But I went to a place called Trident Junior High in Anaheim. And any place, you know, at lunchtime, seagulls, you know, that's free meals for seagulls. So they just invaded the campus every lunchtime. So one day at a particularly bad moment for me, man, I got it right on top of the head, right in front of the school bully, and I, you know, never lived it down. And it was a terrible moment. I'm scarred. It explains a lot about me, and for those of you who know me. So anyway, good to have the birds around here, isn't it? All right, we're in Acts chapter 5. Let me tell you a story before we get started on that. Years ago in Germany, there was a young Jewish boy who had a profound sense of admiration for his father. The life of the family centered around kind of religious acts. They were a devoted Jewish family. And the father was very zealous in attending Jewish worship and the instruction that was demanded of the children. And so he taught in the home, as a good Jewish parent would, and frankly, as a good Christian parent should. While the boy was a teenager, the family, they lived in Germany, as I said, they were forced to move from one town in Germany to another town. And in this new location, there was no synagogue, and frankly, all the influential people in the community belonged to the Lutheran Church. Jewish tradition, of course, and Lutheran Church, they don't go too well together. And so the family was stunned when the dad said, you know what, we are now going to be Lutherans. And it was not because the father had a conversion experience. It was simply because as a Lutheran, it was going to be easier for him to do business in this new town, and he let them know that was the reason for the change, not because of a sincere and authentic conversion to Christianity or to Christ, but because it was financially better to do this. And of course, the whole family was stunned. Later on, as the kid got older, he left Germany to study in England. He sat daily at the British Museum formulating his ideas and composing a book. In that book, he introduced a whole life and worldview, and it started a movement that was designed truly to change the world. In the book, he described religion as the opiate of the people. Those of you who are history scholars know that I'm talking about Karl Marx, and the book was the Communist Manifesto. This kid had been deeply scarred by the hypocrisy of his father, and it played a significant role in his life to the point that truly it influenced the whole world. Billions are still living under this system of communism, which has not been a friend of the people, but has been an enemy. Hypocrisy was and still is the biggest danger for the people of God. It destroys unity within the church, and it destroys our witness to the outside world. It is an insidious plot of Satan to keep God's plan from unfolding in the earth. Now, we're in Acts chapter 5 this morning, but since we haven't been there for a while, I want to give us just kind of a refresher to get us all up to date and on the same page. Chapter 5 opens with the story of a couple, a married couple, named Ananias and Sapphira. And they've come down to us with great dishonor. Any Bible scholar, you hear the words, the names Ananias and Sapphira, you know exactly. We're not going to a nice place today. This is not going to be a wonderful, lovely, flowery message whatsoever because of what happened so long ago with Ananias and Sapphira. But leading up to this, here's where it's been in the book of Acts. In chapter 1 of Acts, Jesus ascends to heaven after he gives his disciples the command to be his witnesses, right? Remember they ask him, are you going to establish the kingdom now? And he said, that's none of your business. What is your business is to go be witnesses for me, and you're going to start in Jerusalem, and it's going to spread throughout the whole known world at that time. But he said, wait for the Holy Spirit to show up before you start opening your mouths, all right? So go, wait, and don't do anything until the Holy Spirit comes. Well, in Acts chapter 2, Holy Spirit comes, and it's pretty unmistakable that he's there, and the church is born. Peter gives this message, and 3,000 people come to faith in Christ after seeing the miracle of the followers of Christ speak in tongues that were known languages, and the people understood their own language being spoken, and they were amazed because these were not scholars doing this. These were Galileans. They were not known for their intellect. They were kind of known as country bumpkins, if you will. And here they were, flawlessly delivering the message of the gospel in different languages, and everybody was amazed at that. Then Peter starts standing up and preaching and interpreting what's going on. And that the heart of his message was Jesus and the resurrection in the very same place where Jesus had been crucified, not even 60 days before this. In the very same place. And so 3,000 came to faith in Christ. In chapter 3, Peter and John are going to the temple to pray, and there's a guy begging, and he's a lame guy, and everybody knows him. He's the village lame guy. And he was at the temple all the time, and they heal him. The guy gets up, starts praising God, jumping and shouting and praising God. And for their efforts for this terrible act on this guy, the Pharisees come and arrest them in chapter 4. And they basically say, what authority do you do this in? And Peter says, okay, well, since you're asking us, and if I need to give a defense for a good deed done to this guy, let me tell you that it's by Jesus that this happened. Now, again, these are the same people. They knew Jesus. These are the same guys. These are the same guys that had to deal with him. And now they got to deal with 12 more just like him, doing the same stuff. They're not amused. And so they say, well, we want you to stop teaching in this guy's name. And Peter says, look, guys, if you think it's better for us to obey you than God, you know, get a clue. We're going to obey God, not you. I entitled that message, Holy Spirit Chutzpah. All right? It was kind of an in-your-face to the religious leaders. And that's what happened in chapter 4. And then chapter 4 ends by giving this beautiful description of the church and how they were taking care of one another, because there was great financial need for Christians in Jerusalem at this time, because, again, they had gone off the reservation as far as what they were supposed to be doing. And a lot of them were having their businesses boycotted in Jerusalem. And so there was big-time financial need. And so they were taking care of each other. And one of the ways they were doing that, and at the end of chapter 4, you get this guy named Barnabas, who will appear in Acts as a significant figure. He sells a piece of land and takes the money and brings it to the apostles so it can be distributed among the needy people in the church. And that's how chapter 4 ends. All right, then comes chapter 5. Chapter 5. Now in chapter 5, we have the first sign of trouble from the inside. There's been external persecution, and there will be more, but now we got trouble coming from the inside, and frankly, that's the worst kind of trouble that can happen. As you'll see, it is dealt with by God very quickly and very decisively. The very uniqueness of this story points to the authenticity of the story. So as we read it, we're not reading first century myth here. We're reading about something that actually happened in Jerusalem to this couple. So here we go, Acts chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, you can follow along. Otherwise, it'll be on the screen. But, by the way, whenever you see the word but in Scripture, you know you're going to be dealing with something that is vastly different from what came before. But a man named Ananias and his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property, and with his wife's knowledge, he kept back for himself some of the proceeds and brought only a part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, "Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to God, to man, but to God." When Ananias heard these words, he fell down and breathed his last, and great fear came upon all those who heard it. The young men rose and wrapped him up and carried him out and buried him. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. And Peter said to her, "Tell me whether you sold the land for so much." And she said, "Yes, for so much." But Peter said to her, "How is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out." Immediately she fell down at her feet and breathed her last. When the young men came in and found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband, and great fear came upon the whole church and upon all those who heard these things. Here's the point today. This passage makes it clear that God is not fooled by and is not amused with the duplicity of his people. That's the point. Here's point number one to get there. God's judgment is always first directed to his people. This is another instance of a biblical writer telling us a story that is not at all complementary to the cause. This is not a story you wanted to go shout from the housetops in Jerusalem about what was going on in the church. It was a story that was somewhat shameful. Luke very honestly tells his readers that while there were, of course, very many good people in this new thing called the church, like Barnabas, who he describes at the end of chapter 4, there were also those who were less than noble in their devotion to God and their devotion to one another, and Ananias and Sapphira were two examples of that. Now, the Bible is not it's not propaganda for a cause. The Bible speaks bluntly, honestly, of the flaws of its greatest heroes. I mean, you go through Scripture. Abraham was a coward and a liar as well as a man of great faith. We have instances where he lied about his wife being his sister, and I don't have time to get into everything, but he was flawed. Jacob, I mean, my goodness, if you read about Jacob in Genesis, you wonder, how in the world? I mean, man, I'm a saint compared to this guy, and he's a patriarch. Moses had the impudence to tell God that God had gotten the wrong guy for the job. "I don't want to do it. I can't speak." And he had a laundry list of excuses why he didn't want to lead the people out of Egypt. God finally had to say, "Look, you're doing it, and Aaron will speak for you, okay?" David, a man after God's own heart, also was an adulterer, and then to cover up his adultery, used his position as king to make sure that a very good man got killed in battle, the husband of the woman he committed adultery with. Not quite an act of murder, but not exactly David's finest moment. Peter was blustery and he was a loose cannon. He failed Jesus at Jesus' greatest moment of need before becoming the bold and compelling explainer of the gospel that we see throughout the book of Acts. Paul was a first century religious terrorist before becoming a missionary. He was. There's no other word for it in terms of our modern. He was a terror. He was out hunting down those who were part of this movement called the Way, intending in many cases to make sure they died. So the things we see today are not new. This stuff happened, and the Bible is very clear that the greatest heroes had feet of clay. And that's the point. It's all about God. It's not about us. It's about His grace and mercy. And it's about what He's doing. And no one should ever be placed on such a high pedestal that they can't. And so that's the point. And the Bible's very honest about it. Now, this passage is a miracle passage. It's not the kind of miracle you want to see all the time because it's a miracle of instant judgment. Obviously, if that happened today, man, all the time, we'd be in big trouble, wouldn't we? Through this, and here's the thing, God was making a very bold statement to His church at this very early part of its life. So just as there were other miracles going on that were of a real positive nature, you have this one over here of a very negative nature, and God is making a point not only in these positive things, but also in this very negative thing. And the point is that hypocrisy is serious, and God is not amused at the using of His name for any kind of dishonesty or religious showboating. Ever. He has never been about that. Here's a passage from 1 Peter chapter 4 to kind of explain this first point. 1 Peter 4 verse 17, it says this, Peter writing, the same guy that gave the message, "For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God?" Peter's making it pretty serious here. He's saying, look, if God's going to judge things right here and now, He's going to judge the people who are speaking His name the most. Those are the people that God is most concerned about getting in line at this stage. And the reason is clear, and I go to this passage first, because all too often, we are wanting God to judge the unrighteous world around us, don't we? Man, we want Him to come very forcefully and set things right now. But God's design has been and always has been to have a people who represent Him, because now is not the time for the final judgment. That time is coming. That's why Jesus says in Matthew 7, "Judge not, lest you yourself be judged. For in the way you judge others, it's going to come back on you." So if you're a harsh, judgmental person, guess what? If that's the standard you prefer to use, guess who's going to get the brunt of it eventually? It will be you. God is the one who judges. That's always been His job, not ours. Not yours, not mine. Not the church's. Now, yeah, we can judge behavior, we can analyze, and we can do all, but it's not our job to pronounce final condemning judgment on anyone. That's God's alone, not ours. And we kind of want God to make things right. Now, this being the case, since He's decided to use people in this, He needs a people who can be depended upon to carry His message of reconciliation to the world that He loves. God so loved the world that He gave, and He wants us to carry this message of reconciliation. What He doesn't want or need is a bunch of self-satisfied hypocrites who stink up the message and use God's name as a way in ways that God does not want His name used. Does that make sense? Too often we think of the command, "Do not take the name of the Lord your God in vain," to mean merely, "Don't use God's name in profanity." Well, folks, that is small stuff compared to what's going on here. It really is. The whole nature of not using God's name in vain is to not use God's name in a way that is going to bring disrepute upon God Himself. In other words, not to use His name as a commercial for all kinds of other junk. He's not amused by it. Note in this passage that Peter asked Ananias why Satan had put into his heart to lie to the Holy Spirit. And in verse 4, he says, you have not lied to man, but to God. This highlights the point that the Holy Spirit, by the way, is God. The Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Just as a parent will exercise more discipline on their own children in order to make them better people, right? The Bible explains that God does the same with his people. And so when we talk about judgment, we have to understand that Scripture is talking about you and I. In so many cases, us. And one of the big things that God wants to get rid of in his people is the sin of hypocrisy. In this very early instance, as the church is just being born, God deals with it very decisively. Second point is this. The sin of Ananias and Sapphira, the sins of Ananias and Sapphira were stealing from the church and hypocrisy. Let's read the passage again, just part of it, starting in verse 1. But a man named Ananias and his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property, and with his wife's knowledge, he kept back for himself some of the proceeds and brought only a part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Why is it that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to man, but to God. After an interval of about 3 hours, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened, and Peter said to her, tell me whether you have sold the land for so much. And she said, yes, for so much. But Peter said to her, how is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out. So let's get the setting once again. Luke had just finished describing the situation that existed in the Jerusalem church related to how they were taking care of one another. And he used Barnabas as a positive example of one who, in just generosity, compelled and led by God, sold some property and brought all of the proceeds and laid it at Peter's feet and the rest of the apostles, and they were going to distribute that to the people in the church who had need. Now, Ananias and his wife, they do the same thing, right? They do the same thing. They sell their piece of property, but they did two things. They did two things that were duplicitous. First of all, they held back some of the money. Now, that would have been fine in and of itself. Peter makes it clear, right? The property was yours. You could do with it what you wanted before it was sold. And after it was sold, frankly, you could use the money any way you wanted. But there's a word here used in the text that they held back. So, and it's the same word used, if you're familiar with the Old Testament, in the story of Achan, who had held back some stuff when the Israelites were told not to take anything from the camp of a people they had just defeated. And Achan hoarded some of the stuff and took it, basically stole. He took something that didn't belong to him. So there's a feeling here that either Ananias and Sapphira had made a previous arrangement with the apostles saying, okay, we're going to sell the property, we're going to bring it all to you. And then subsequently made a decision to not bring it all, but still saying they were bringing it all. In other words, the essence, the way it's worded here, it was in a sense they were stealing what didn't belong to them. It did belong to them, but once they had said, it's all yours, and then took it back without being honest about it, it's like stealing. And that's the way the passage kind of put it. And that's because of that word for held back. And then the second sin, of course, was hypocrisy. They only brought part of it and said, we brought the whole thing. Barnabas looked good. Barnabas is kind of being honored. And they're saying, hey, that's pretty cool. I guess a way to become renowned in this church is to do these acts of generosity. And so we want the same honor that Barnabas has. So we're going to do the same thing, only they agreed together. I mean, what was that conversation like between Ananias and Sapphira as they sold this property? I don't know what it was like, but we can use our imaginations. Maybe, you know what? Yeah, I know we told the apostles we're going to bring the whole thing, but you know what? Business is down. Doesn't tell us what Ananias did for a living. Man, we got some bills we can't pay for here. We can't give the whole thing. Well, you know, let's just say we give the whole thing. Yeah, that'll work. I mean, we're still giving, right? We don't have to. We're still giving. I mean, there could have been all kinds of mental gymnastics to say that what they were doing was really okay. Right? We're familiar with that sort of thinking. Don't look at me like you're not familiar with that kind of thinking. All right, I know that because I'm capable of it too. We all are, right? So at a certain point, they decided, we're not going to give the whole thing. We're going to make it look like we did. So those were the two sins. Next point is this. In this event, there are three valuable lessons for God's people. So what are they? The first lesson is this. The destructive nature of hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is destructive. But Peter said, here's the passage, Acts 5, 3a and 4b. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? You have not lied to man, but to God. 21st century Americans have lost sight of the complete holiness and otherness of God. We treat God like a benevolent, powerless daddy. And we forget the picture of him in Scripture. And even though we have access to him, and Christ has done this wonderful thing to allow us to come into his presence, we're still dealing with a being of awesome majesty and complete purity. That's who we're dealing with. In the end, hypocrisy was an offense against God. Yeah, it was an offense against the church too, but primarily it was an offense to God. Because it was using his name to do something dishonest. He takes it personally. If you insist on using his name to try to make it seem like you are better than you are, he does not view that as a harmless little prank. Especially as it relates to being his organized people in the church. Oswald Chambers wrote a long time ago, "The world is glad of an excuse not to listen to the gospel message, and the inconsistencies of Christians is the best excuse you can come up with." Right? How many of you have heard, the church is full of hypocrites? And that's true. And you wish you could talk them down from that statement, but you know you can't. And so you say, well, we need one more, so come and join us. Right? We're incomplete without you. Now here's the deal, and please understand the context here. This is in Jerusalem. This is not long, very long after Jesus was dealing with the religious leaders and scribes and Pharisees and teachers of the law, right? What was their biggest problem? Hypocrisy. Matthew 23, if you want a nice read someday, go to Matthew 20. I'm going to read you part of it here. Jesus, in his final confrontation with the Pharisees before he went to the cross, he kind of sets this up with first he speaks to his disciples in Matthew 23, and he says, look, the scribes, the Pharisees, the leaders, give them due respect because of their position of authority. They sit in the seat of Moses. In other words, they're teachers of the law. So you need to give them their respect because of their office, because of their position. But don't do what they do. Do not follow their example. Why not? Well, because they don't practice what they preach, because they use their teaching to oppress people, because they act high and mighty, and they love self-importance. And then Jesus says that the greatest among his disciples will be the servant of all, and that was exactly the thing the Pharisees were not doing. They were not leading as servants. In fact, they were just beating people up left and right spiritually. Jesus said he had great compassion for the people of Jerusalem because they were wandering around like sheep without a shepherd. Well, these people were supposed to be the shepherds. They're supposed to be taking care of the flock of God, and they were abusing religiously the flock of God. Then he's speaking to his disciples. Then he turns directly. Now you get this picture in your mind. This is Jesus, and these guys are the power brokers in Jerusalem. I mean, these are the city council people. These are the political leaders. These are religious leaders, and they look all very impressive. They're all dressed up, and Jesus is just this peasant from Galilee, but he's had this unbelievable ministry for 3 years, and these guys have been hounding him for 3 years, and it's almost as if Jesus takes all that pent-up energy that he's been holding on for 3 years, and he just lets it fly. This is not meek and mild, nice, friendly, harmless Jesus. Listen to what he says. And I'm going to read from the Message, because I think the language from the Message paraphrase is more the emotional impact that the Pharisees would have. So here's what Jesus said to them in love, all right? I've had it with you. You're hopeless. You religion scholars, you Pharisees, frauds. Your lives are roadblocks to God's kingdom. You refuse to enter, and you won't let anyone else enter either. You're hopeless, you religion leaders and Pharisees, frauds. You go halfway around the world to make a convert, but once you get him and make him into a replica of yourself, you're double damned. You're hopeless. What arrogant stupidity. You say, if someone makes a promise with his fingers crossed, that's nothing. But if he swears with his hand on the Bible, that's serious. What ignorance. Does the leather of the Bible carry more weight than the skin on your hands? And what about this piece of trivia? If you shake hands on a promise, that's nothing. But if you raise your hand to God as your witness, then that's serious. What ridiculous hair splitting. What difference does it make whether you shake hands or raise hands? A promise is a promise. What difference does it make if you make your promise inside or outside of the house of worship? A promise is a promise. God is present, watching, and holding you accountable regardless. You're hopeless. You religion scholars and Pharisees, frauds. You keep meticulous account books, tithing on every nickel and dime you get. But on the meat of God's law, things like fairness and compassion and commitment, the absolute basics, you carelessly take it or leave it. Careful bookkeeping is commendable, but the basics are required. You don't have any idea how silly you look. Writing a life story that's wrong from start to finish, nitpicking over commas and semicolons. You're hopeless, you religion scholars and Pharisees, frauds. You burnish the surface of your cups and bowls so that they sparkle in the sun, while the insides are maggoty with greed and gluttony. Stupid Pharisee, scour the insides, and then the gleaming surface will mean something. You're hopeless, you religion leaders, scholars, Pharisees, frauds. You're like manicured grave plots, grass clipped and flowers bright, but 6 feet down, it's all rotting bones and worm-eaten flesh. People look at you and think you're saints, but beneath the skin, you're total frauds. You're hopeless, you religion scholars and Pharisees, frauds. You build granite tombs for your prophets and marble monuments for your saints, and you say that if we had lived in those days of our ancestors, we would not have killed them with our hands. You protest too much. You're cut from the same cloth as those who murdered them. And daily, you add to the death count. Snakes, reptilian snakes. Do you think you can worm your way out of this? How will you escape being sentenced to hell? Dude. He's not amused, is he? So why do I take the time, when time is short, to read that whole dang thing? Because hypocrisy is the most dangerous and deadly sin that can inhabit a church. It is the normal course of events, listen, that those who become serious about God, which I hope all of us are, right? Serious, God should be taken somewhat seriously. That when we get serious about him and we get... That we begin to display our spirituality by going to church in ways that are put before us to display our spirituality and to come into worship and to gather, right? And to have outward symbols that we respect, like communion, like coming to worship, like singing, like praying, like giving. All of these things that are external manifestations. The problem is that internally it's not matched. All of this external stuff becomes just showboating and nothing more. And nothing more. And it's always a danger of those who begin to take God seriously to become hypocritical in religious practices. That is always a danger. It is ever forced. It is ever present. It's ever out there. And we have to watch it. We have to be aware of it. As a result of it, the reputation of the people of Jesus is destroyed and the credibility of the church is trashed, with the result that the message of the gospel goes on being not believed and people go to hell. Because they see the church and they don't want any part of it. Listen to this. A study in 2013, a research project was done by the Barna Group, a guy named David Kinneman. And what they wanted to find out was this. What are the practices of professing Christians? Do we have attitudes and actions that match the attitudes and actions of Jesus? Or do our attitudes and actions more closely match the attitudes and actions that we know about the Pharisees and the teachers of the law and the religious leaders of the New Testament? In other words, are we more like Jesus or are we more like Pharisees? That's a good question, right? And they had 20, I don't have time to go into the whole study and the questions that they asked and all that, but here's the results. Using 20 questions that talked about attitudes and actions of Jesus and attitudes and actions of the Pharisees, the researchers created an aggregate score and all of that, and there were four categories. The categories were these at the end. There were people who had Christ-like, they were Christ-like in action and attitude. There were people who were Christ-like in action but not attitude. There were people who were Christ-like in attitude but not action, and there were people who were Christ-like in neither. Professing believers, evangelical churches, the findings reveal that most self-identified Christians in the United States are characterized by having the attitudes and actions that researchers identified as, guess what? Pharisaical. Is it any wonder that we have a great vast majority of the population, at least 96% of the population of the United States, are not atheists? Maybe 4% are real atheists. Maybe. 96% have some belief in God. And when you ask people about Jesus, Jesus usually gets a pretty favorable review. Yeah, I think he's a good guy. I mean, they maybe totally misunderstand him. Like, they probably wouldn't go to passages like I just read and say, yeah, Jesus was like that. But they have basically a favorable view of Jesus. But when it comes to the church, they don't want anything to do with it. Why? Because in our attempt to display Christ-likeness and become religious, we have become Pharisaical. And the tragedy is that all too often we're blind to it. And therefore, every now and then, it's got to be pointed out. And that's the first problem. That's the first lesson. Hypocrisy is destructive. It destroys our unity as a church, and it destroys our witness to the world. The second message that we need to learn from this is the importance of openness and a clear conscience. Peter says this, why is it you've contrived this deed in your heart? In Acts 5, 4b is that verse. And then in Acts 5:9, he says, how is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of God? In order to not be hypocritical, two things need to go hand in hand. Openness, which is living a life of transparency. In other words, living with nothing to hide. However, since no one is perfect, our living openly demands that we are quick to admit our flaws, right? So the idea is this, we live life openly, you know, with not behind closed doors, with nothing to hide, but as we live our lives, we're going to make mistakes, we're going to mess up, we're going to do things that hurt other people and offend, and so openness requires us to be open about that too, and freely admit, freely ask forgiveness, and of course, give out forgiveness. Having a clear conscience means to live in a way that you do not pile up regrets, but that when you do wrong to someone, you're quick to apologize. And you make any amends necessary. That's what it means to be open and transparent and have a clear conscience. It's not complicated stuff, right? We all understand it. I mean, a kid of three, when you ask them something about whether they took your drink off the table, and they think in their little three-year-old mind, ooh, if I say the right answer, I'm in trouble. Therefore, I will avoid trouble. And you don't even have to teach them to do this, do you? You all know. Kids are not honest. They are big, fat liars. You guys ought to understand that. Every one of them out for self-preservation. And as a result of that, very early on, they get a guilty conscience. And they might come and say, Mommy, I'm sorry, I lied. Maybe. Maybe later, like when they're 30. Hey, remember when I did that? Yeah. That really didn't happen. Living with a clear conscience, it's important. And hypocrisy just messes us up from the inside out. And so it's important. In Acts chapter 24, the Apostle Paul speaking says, so I always take pains to have a clear conscience, both toward God and man. And as they contrived together, Ananias and Sapphira hit a point where they began to justify their wrong action. No doubt their consciences were telling them not to do this, but they decided to violate this God-given moral barometer available to everyone, and not to mention the Holy Spirit in their lives, and they went ahead with the act anyway, with ruinous results in their case. The final one is the importance of discipline in the church. This is a difficult part of the truth of this matter. The church in America and other Western democracies has been on the decline for decades, despite the fact that we make it easy to be a part of the church and rarely, if ever, call people in the church to real accountability for actions that would adversely affect the reputation of Christ and the witness of the church. We hardly ever do it. We're so afraid that people are going to leave, we invite them in almost at all costs. And it hasn't helped. We haven't grown. We're declining. You go back to the first century, and frankly, things are happening in China. It's almost harder to get into the church. Believe me, in China, where it's dangerous to be a church member, if somebody is coming into the church, you don't think they're going to ask them two or three questions about sincerity of faith? Since this person could turn you over to the government and things could get really bad for you real quick. It's hard. It's hard. In those settings where the message of Christ is persecuted, to actually get in. Here it's easy. And yet there the church is on the increase and here the church is in decline. Why? One of the reasons I'm convinced is because we have lost this sense. We have lost the sense that our lives matter, that the way we conduct our lives before the world matters, that hypocrisy is no big deal. It's not a problem. Everybody's a hypocrite, therefore it's not a problem. God's not striking people dead today because of hypocrisy. Maybe. Frankly, we don't know, do we? When we've called people to account, it is usual, and when we do it, it is usually for sexual misconduct, and we should do that. But then we ignore things like gossip, dishonest business practice, fractious behaviors, causing splits in churches, and behaving in a way that upsets the unity of the body of Christ. Those things that people have carte blanche to do. Don't mess around sexually. We've gotten that message pretty good. But you can pretty much go ahead and do it. You can character assassinate all day long. No problem. We're never going to call you on that. The message here is that God is very concerned that the body of Christ does not act in a duplicitous way for all of the reasons that we've already mentioned. This is the body. It's not the body of Mike, thank God. It is the body of Christ. Do you think he's not going to take that at least a little bit seriously? Let me put it this way in question form. How would you feel if every day thousands of people used your name to manipulate money from people for supposedly good cause when in reality it's been used for extravagant living? They were using your name to do that. How would you like if people were using your name to rant against sexual sins and others while behind the scenes you're living lives of unrestrained sexual appetite? How would you like it if people used your name to shout family values from the rooftop while abusing spouses and children? How would you like it if people used your name to declare how much they love everyone, while in virtually every conversation they make it a point to character assassinate at least one person per day just for fun? How would you like it if people were using your name and saying they were thankful for God's forgiveness while being totally unwilling to forgive anyone else the slightest offense being done to them? And God deals with that every day, all day long, by people that say they love him and know him. And it's us. We can't look outside and say it's those bleeps out there, right? It's us. It's the church. You get the idea. We are called Christians. The name of Jesus is attached to us. How must Christ feel every single day as his name is held in disrepute because people are too blind to see their own duplicity and the church has no will or appetite to call it out? Now, of course, it's dangerous to call somebody else out, isn't it? But certainly we can do that without falling into the category of hypocrisy. Paul says in Galatians chapter 6 that when a brother or sister is tripped up in sin, go restore them. You who are spiritual, restore them. But do this in an attitude of humility, knowing that that could be you. That's the way you stay away from hypocrisy. People are not going to take kindly to being challenged on anything, right? You don't. The defenses go up, all that. But it's necessary. It's the body of Christ. We're calling each other to live lives of Christ-likeness. And we all understand that that's not an easy thing to do. which is all the more reason for us to hold each other accountable. That's why small groups are important. Because when you meet in a large setting like this, that's probably not going to happen to the extent that it will in a smaller kind of setting where you're around friends and you guys can be honest with each other and you can talk about what you struggle with. Talk about how you failed and how others can come along and restore you. That's how it's supposed to work. And man, that's what we're going to be trying to do here. That's what we're going to be trying to do here. Most of the evil in the world does not come from evil people. It comes from people who consider themselves good. They have great intentions. And yet live lives of hypocrisy. So, what is the Spirit saying to you right now? We're coming to communion here. Oh, isn't this going to be fun? And I meant the message to be a little heavy, and I hope you understand that when I said, first of all, a message like this, I don't enjoy, you know, I got to teach it because it's in the Bible, right? It's here. I can't avoid it. I can't ignore it. I can't pretend it's not. We can't skip over chapter 5 of Acts because it's unpleasant, right? We can't. And now we're going to come to communion, one of those external things we do to tell God we love Him, and as a symbol, and Jesus tells us to do this in remembrance of Him, right? But Paul also tells us when we come to the Lord's table, don't do this in an unworthy manner. This is just not something you check off your spiritual to-do list and everything is hunky-dory and A-OK now because you've done it. That's superstition. That's mere religion. When we come here today after a message like this, I think it's incumbent upon us that before we come here today that we truly do a little self-evaluation before we come to the Lord's table. And we take the moments where the band's going to be playing there's going to be some quiet except for the nice bird chirping over here, which is kind of nice, isn't it? And use the bird as the voice of the Holy Spirit to you right now. Beauty, wanting us to be, and you know, look at that little sparrow. I don't know where he went. Apparently I scared him away because I mentioned him, he's shy. Where Jesus says, consider the sparrows. You know, they're really cheap. People sacrifice these things and they only pay a few pennies for a sparrow. How much more valuable are you to your Father in heaven? How much more valuable are you to your Father in heaven who desires you to live a consistent life where Christ-likeness is being formed in you and where you are a sweet scent to the world out there rather than a grave? Band can come up. As I pray, the next step, do you respect Christ? At this early stage of the life of His church, He made it clear that any attempt to deceive other believers is in reality an attempt to deceive God. So, is there anything that you need to confess to Him today? And is there anything you need to make right with someone else? Man, if there's something there, if there's something out there, and either you're not forgiving someone, I would not say don't go to somebody who has no knowledge of your attitude towards them. Okay, don't go tell someone, hey, I had really lousy thoughts of you yesterday. Okay, probably keep that to yourself. However, if you have publicly and you know you've hurt somebody and you know that you've hurt them and you know that a barrier is now coming in your relationship, this would be a wonderful time to seek forgiveness for that. And by the way, if you're the one that's been wrong and somebody comes and seeks forgiveness, guess what your job is? Right? You've been forgiven more sins than you could ever forgive by Jesus. Have that attitude. Let's pray. And here's the way we do communion here, if you're doing it with us for the first time. As the band plays, I'm going to ask Keith Larson to come and help me serve communion. We'll be standing up here. You'll form two lines in the center aisle. One on your right, one on your left. Just come down, receive both elements, the bread and the cup as you come down. If you can't, get up and walk. Have somebody get the elements for you and then bring them back to you. While the music is playing and you're either standing in line or you're back at your seat, just take these moments. Take these moments to connect with God. Confess to Him anything that you think you need to say, Lord, man, this is really off kilter in my life right now. I need to make this right with You. Give me the courage, if there's somebody else you need to make this right with, Lord, give me the courage to go apologize, to make it right with them, because You're concerned with the purity of Your body and the unity of Your body. This is Your body, it's not mine. Lord, help me to respect that and to act in ways that will bring great pleasure to you and glory to the body of Christ. Not because I can do this on my own, but because I have the Holy Spirit in me. Thank you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. Sometimes your word comes to us, big time pushback, like today. Lord, there is something in your word for every culture, for every person. There are many things, of course, that we just embrace and we love. When it says, God so loved the world, and Jesus, when you say, let the children come to me, for this kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. We rejoice when, Jesus, we see you beating up the bad guys and saying, he who is without sin, you cast the first stone. But when we're challenged, as in a passage like this, with some of our own duplicity, then, Lord, it's at those moments where we really need to fall back on the grace and mercy of Jesus without taking it for granted and simply confess to you. Thank you that you give us this avenue. And Lord, I thank you that when the Holy Spirit convicts anyone of anything, it's clean, it's pure, it leads to better actions. It does not produce the shame that Satan wants to bring. So Lord, I pray right now that if there's anyone here sitting here this morning who because of this message is now all of a sudden just crushed with shame, that they would understand that that's not what the Holy Spirit's after. The Holy Spirit is simply after restoration, healing, moving on, not paralysis. And so, God, I pray that it would be clean. And as we come today to receive the bread and the cup, those two things that represent the body and the blood of Jesus, that necessary sacrifice for us, that we will do so with hearts and with minds and with actions that you can be proud of, even if we have to admit our wrongs. Thank you, Jesus, for your forgiveness, for your grace, and for your mercy. You don't do to us what we deserve, and then you give us something that we do not deserve. And we thank you so much. Help us never to take it for granted. In your name we pray. Amen.